Hello, I'm Nick Offerman, white male translator for Gaslit Nation. To sum up this week's episode, kleptocracy anywhere is kleptocracy everywhere. And this is a transnational crime syndicate masquerading as a government. Thanks for listening.
I'm Sarah Kendzior, the author of the best-selling essay collection, The View from Flyover Country, and the upcoming book, Hiding in Plain Sight.
I'm ANDREA CHALUPA, a journalist and filmmaker, and the writer and producer of the upcoming journalistic thriller, Mr. Jones.
And this is Gaslit Nation, a podcast covering corruption in the Trump administration and rising autocracy around the world. As regular listeners know, Gaslit Nation has long stood in favor of impeaching the motherfucker. And over the last 3 weeks, we finally saw it start to happen. I watched it in real time like a sucker, but ANDREA luckily got to escape 11 hours per day of GOP hell and go abroad. So before we get into all the testimony and all the lies, ANDREA is going to tell us what she was up to while Devin Nunes was stalking her sister.
Yeah, that's always fun to travel abroad when the GOP, the Kremlin-backed GOP, is targeting someone you love, because they always go after family as well, as we say, as we remind people on the show. So I had an interesting trip. I was invited abroad. These were invitations that were from the grassroots, meaning word of mouth is getting around about my film, Mr. Jones, which is very much a historical drama of how Kremlin disinformation is aided by corruption in the West. Kremlin propaganda cannot succeed without the help of the West. It's a mirror of what we're dealing with today. It's a beautiful film directed by Agnieszka Holland. It won essentially the Oscar of Poland. It's a Polish co-production. And interesting grassroots groups and festivals invited me abroad, including starting with Poland, which is dealing with its own Trumpian government that is trying to purge the judiciary. There are protests against that that have happened the last few days. So that was an interesting place to be during this time. So I was invited to Warsaw for an incredible conference called Outriders, which seeks to address how to essentially fix journalism. And it brings together all these innovative minds from around the world on people who are confronting saving journalism, how to practice journalism today in the 21st century. And we had journalists that live in Sudan, in Southeast Asia, and all over the world dealing with their own hotspots and coming together and sharing really interesting insights into some volcanic sort of regions of the world. And I was thrilled to be there and inspired, incredibly inspired. And so I gave a presentation on Mr. Jones because it's a story that raises up the importance of investigative journalism and how it's never been a more dangerous time for journalism, and we need it now more than ever. And one of the organizers of this festival turned out to be a Gaslit Nation listener. So that was really cool. Hello to you, Jakob, in Warsaw. And then I went to Norway to the incredible Movies on War Festival in Elverum, Norway, which is about an hour or so outside of Oslo. And Movies on War is essentially what Gaslit Nation would be as a film festival. They bring all these incredible movies that are confronting some really important issues. So there are two powerful documentaries, for instance, on Syria. One is called The Cave, a documentary that I watched on a team of doctors in Syria, including a woman by the name of Amani Balor, who risked her life to save countless, countless people. And it just shows their heroism under these extreme conditions. And of course, again, you see the courage of women under fire and women taking leadership roles, running towards the danger. And then another powerful film, which I didn't see, but I've heard a lot about, which I think I look forward to seeing and I encourage people to see. And it's another incredible documentary on Syria called For Sama. For Sama is about a mother, a filmmaker in Syria who fell in love and had a daughter named Sama during the Syrian war. And so she picks up a camera and documents everything for her daughter. The film is called For Sama. It's won a ton of awards. And it's just such a beautiful and powerful, from what I've read, documentation on what life was like inside Syria from the eyes of a mother and capturing it all for her daughter, an important human rights record. And so when I was at Movies on War, meeting with incredible organizers there, including Osteen. Hello, Osteen, another Gaslit Nation listener. I gave a presentation on my film, Mr. Jones, which screened at the festival. And one thing I pointed out is that, you know, my film, Mr. Jones, shows, it documents essentially a horrific little-known genocide, Stalin's genocide famine, which killed millions of people in the Soviet Union in 1933. The vast majority of the victims were Ukrainian. And Western journalists, powerful Western journalists, including at the New York Times, helped the Soviet censors cover this up in exchange for greater access to the Soviet regime. This was a horrific, extreme example of the dangers of access journalism. And even though Stalin got away with this mass murder and the famine in Ukraine largely remained hidden for generations, my film still stands as an important testament to what was done. So I held that up as an example of, with these documentaries on Syria, even though Syria is the world's karma, it is horrific what has been done to the Syrians and the Kurds and so forth, what Assad and Putin has done and the miscalculations by the West to try to stop this bloodshed. Even though Syria is ongoing and it's heartbreaking, it's absolutely beyond devastating. These documentaries are so essential in providing an independent record to give back dignity to the countless victims and their relatives for many generations to come and say that, yes, this did happen. Eyewitness accounts themselves, that existence of eyewitness accounts themselves are hope. I was very touched by those documentaries, an important reminder that regimes like Assad's regime and Putin's regime, they crumble under the weight of truth. And so that's why we need these eyewitness testimonies and need to preserve them, because if Assad wins, and it looks like he is, we've abandoned the Syrian people. If Assad wins, then generations from now, if the Assad family remains in control in Syria, they'll say none of this happened. They'll whitewash it. Putin's regime will whitewash it. So these documentaries are defiant, and they're the living truth. And so people have to understand how important those types of works are. Then from Norway, I went to Helsinki, Finland, for another screening of Mr. Jones, which was organized by the Ukrainian community in Helsinki. And I opened up my remarks by saying that Mr. Jones was energetically cleansing Helsinki after the Putin and Trump summit. So the audience liked that. They appreciated that. And while in Helsinki, I met a Finnish journalist who reported from Donbass, which is a part of region of eastern Ukraine under Russian occupation. And she was telling me how it was Mad Max over there with all these drunken or so-called Russian rebels. And then the Russian military was trying to really get them into line and discipline them to the point of just really taking the operation over. Because it is a Russian invasion of Ukraine, first and foremost. And they couldn't rely on the local population to carry out this invasion themselves. And they even released the prisoners to try to create more chaos and just the horrific stuff that she reported on from Donbass. So that was fascinating. And then I came home for Thanksgiving, but on the other side of the world, in Kyiv, my film, Mr. Jones, premiered. Agnieszka Holland, the director, went out for the premiere. James Norton, the star of the film, went out for the premiere to Kyiv. It premiered in the largest theater in Ukraine. It was a huge to-do because this movie was made for Ukrainians, first and foremost. And so it was incredibly a moving experience to finally share it with them. And I got a message from a journalist friend in Kyiv, a Ukrainian journalist, who wrote to me. After seeing the film, she wrote, "Dear Andrea, I was at the Kyiv premiere yesterday, and the movie was so powerful and beautiful. I don't know how we all lived without it and how much pain we were carrying inside. The screening had almost a therapeutic effect. This is the movie every Ukrainian will show their kids and grandchildren. It's that big and important. My feeling was like, I've always needed this story. We've always needed this story. We just didn't know how much we needed it until we saw it." And so that is why we say art matters. And that is why we say that getting your voice out there, providing an eyewitness testimony, even through art, is so powerful and it can have a healing and therapeutic effect. So Mr. Jones, I'm happy to say, is going to be playing in the Washington, D.C. area on December 15th. I'll be there for that screening to do a Q&A. And also Tuesday, December 17th at the AFI Theater in Silver Springs. So please come around for that to finally see the film. And then it goes to theaters across the U.S. and the U.K. in 2020. Thank you for letting me catch up with you. It's been a really sleepless and busy time. So now on with the authoritarian weather report.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you brought up what you did, because I think it's important to remind our audience that, you know, we as Americans are not alone in this battle, like this battle of kleptocracy, of authoritarianism, of censorship, of burying atrocities, like you mentioned in Syria, the danger of that narrative being so distorted and twisted that over time it can be forgotten, which honestly I think is a huge issue that people don't address, is what is going to happen with digital archives lives? What's going to happen with documentation of the 21st century? You know, there was hope initially when all of these atrocities happened in Syria that because they were documented, that one, people would act, and that two, people would know the truth. But because of the nature of digital media and these social media monopolies and, you know, government propaganda, we're in a real danger of that. And, you know, I spent a lot of my career studying the Andijan massacre in Uzbekistan in 2005, which I doubt a lot of people know about. And a lot of the reason people don't know is, you know, well, one, it's Uzbekistan, but two, because all information about it was suppressed by the government, except for the witnesses, who then went online and they created blogs and they told their stories and they posted photos. A lot of that material is now gone because it's now well over 10 years old and it's just disappeared over time. But it's still very important. And as Uzbekistan is gradually opening, you know, it's still an authoritarian state, but not as brutal as it was under Karimov, their former dictator, who died in 2016. Hopefully the full story of Andijan will be told. And I always say, you know, it matters. It matters what all those Uzbek journalists have done for the last 15 years to tell that story, even if it didn't seem like people were listening, even if it didn't seem to make a difference in terms of how their government functioned. It matters inherently because the truth matters inherently. And that's something that we have to remember as we're bombarded with threats, as we're bombarded with propaganda in our own country, you know, and that we have allies facing abroad, that we're in this battle, but there is one quality that can link us together, and that's the pursuit of the truth, even if that truth is painful. And speaking of painful, we can talk about impeachment, because one of the reasons that Andrea and I were demanding these hearings from the moment that the Democrats won the House is because impeachment was an opportunity for different parties to tell their version of the facts or to present evidence in an environment that Trump could not control. It was not like the one-way mechanism of Twitter where he just tweets shit out and people like try to decipher what the hell he means and whether, you know, this misplaced comma means we're now nuking North Korea or whatever. Like, this is a straightforward process. It's a routine. It's a congressional method. It's, you know, extremely old school in Trump's America to have such a formal procedure. Nonetheless, because the Kremlin lackey GOP was involved, it still managed to be a shit show that still presented very relevant testimony and points, you know, due to the high quality witnesses that were on the stand. Before we get to those witnesses, like Marie Yovanovitch, Gordon Sondland, Fiona Hill, and so on, we're going to talk about all of them. If you are familiar with this show, you're probably wondering what the hell was going on with Devin Nunes, the GOP congressman who began every impeachment hearing by rattling off a series of Kremlin talking points like he was the dummy of a bored ventriloquist. And the main talking point he kept coming back to, the one that he just could not get enough of, was Andrea's sister, Alexandra Chalupa.
Violating their own guidelines, Democrats repeatedly redacted from the transcripts the name of Alexandra Chalupa, a former operative for the Democratic National Committee who worked with officials of the Ukrainian embassy in Washington, D.C. in order to smear the Trump campaign in 2016.
Alexandra Chalupa, a contractor for the Democratic National
worked
Committee.
On an election meddling scheme with Ukrainian officials on behalf
Alexandra
of the Democratic
Chalupa,
National Committee. Democratic National Committee operative who colluded with Ukrainian officials to smear the Trump campaign.
Who worked with Ukrainian embassy officials to spread dirt
who
on the Trump campaign.
Worked with Ukrainian officials to collect dirt on the Trump campaign.
Dig up dirt on the Trump
all
campaign.
All of which were aimed at the Trump campaign.
In an effort to influence not only the U.S. voting population, but U.S. government
she
officials.
Met directly about these matters with then-Ukrainian Ambassador Chalet.
Chalupa's actions appear to show that she was simultaneously working on behalf of a foreign government, Ukraine.
Chalupa's activities were one of several indicators of Ukrainian election meddling in 2016, which she provided to the DNC.
And on behalf of the DNC.
Which she passed on to the DNC.
On behalf of the Democratic National Committee
and the Clinton campaign. The first question I have is, were you aware of the anti-Trump efforts by DNC operative Alexandra Chalupa?
I'm not aware of it.
Mr. Holmes, have you met with or do you know Alexandra Chalupa?
No.
The same question for you, Dr. Hill. Do you know or have you met with Alexandra Chalupa?
No.
Did you know of anti-Trump efforts by various Ukrainian officials as well as Alexandra Chalupa, a DNC consultant?
No, I was not aware.
Did you know of anti-Trump efforts by various Ukrainian government officials as well as Alexander Chalupa, a DNC consultant?
I'm not aware of any of these interference efforts.
Ambassador Taylor, you testified to this committee that you only recently became aware of reports of this cooperation between Ukrainian embassy officials and Chalupa to undermine the Trump campaign. From your last deposition, is that correct?
Mr. Nunes, it is correct that I had not known about this before.
That's just going over your last deposition.
That's exactly right.
So, Andrea, what is going on here and why is Devin Nunes obsessed with your sister?
Because he's creepy. And I have a right to give my opinion on that, Devin Nunes, because I live in a free country, and stop trying to turn us into Putin's Russia. No, I think what's getting lost in all this is that Trump's Republican Party, because the Republican Party is now in service to Donald Trump. He's invaded full on. I mean, Donald Trump is the end game of how the Republicans have been treating our democracy, have been treating American people. It's the end game. He's the Frankenstein monster that the Tea Party created, that the Koch brothers created, and so forth. So now they're all out in the open with their xenophobia and misogyny and authoritarian instincts. All of it is out in the open. And so they are not only in service to Trump, but Trump is in service to Putin. So now you have the Republican Party being essentially a propaganda weapon that's furthering the Kremlin's interests. And they're carrying out the Kremlin's playbook by targeting my sister. This is a strategy, as has been reported on, as anybody who's been paying attention could tell you, this is a strategy that was first and foremost led by Paul Manafort, who's now in prison. This is retaliation for my sister, telling anybody who would listen, including Republicans in 2016. She tried to warn Republicans in 2016. She warned journalists. She warned anybody that would listen that Paul Manafort is essentially Putin's operative. And if he's running Donald Trump's campaign, that means the Kremlin is running Donald Trump's campaign. Anybody who was paying close attention to Ukraine knew that Paul Manafort was a close consultant to Yanukovych, Putin's puppet in Ukraine. And so this was obvious to anybody who was paying attention. And so this is just retaliation, plain and simple, that came from Paul Manafort himself. And Paul Manafort, having been on a $10 million a year contract from Putin's close oligarch Deripaska since 2006, he's carrying out this corruption, carrying out this violence against our democracy, like he has against so many countries and parts of the world as a blood money lobbyist. He's doing it to further the Kremlin's interest, to destabilize and divide Putin's opponents. He did this in Ukraine. It's the same playbook. And so the GOP and Devin Nunes carrying out Paul Manafort's playbook is carrying out Putin's playbook, because that is who Paul Manafort was in service to since, as far as we know, since 2006.
And can you debunk some of these myths that they've been saying about your sister? I just want to make sure our audience, because they may have been absorbing the fatuous material of not only the GOP, but a bunch of bro pundits who, among other things, cannot distinguish between you and your sister. Can you just kind of like break down some of these myths, like that she went to Ukraine, like all this kind of shit?
It's been horrendous. I mean, everybody knows that we talk a lot about on this show how journalism is shrinking, newsrooms are shrinking, reporter jobs are disappearing. I know a lot of excellent reporters and editors who have been pushed into other industries because they simply cannot afford to work in journalism any longer. The jobs are just disappearing. And as a result, what you have is a smaller watchdog, and the journalism jobs that are remaining are predominantly white and predominantly male. And that's just to say we're getting our news through a white male lens. We're getting our news through a privileged lens. And so what happens if you look at studies is that women, even women political reporters, get cut out of these conversations. What you have is an echo chamber of white men in the political arena of political journalism just talking to each other. And so what's been really interesting in that is they keep repeating things like using my name instead of my sister's name because they've seen me on Twitter. So they're not really bothering for whatever reason because their lives are not going to be impacted by Trump and his policies. They're not being harassed by the Kremlin's active measures. They're not having state-sponsored hacking on their emails. They're not on the front lines of this because they're white males who are privileged in our society and who, by the very nature of that privilege, have far more credibility. They have more weight in what they do and say. And it's the historically marginalized groups like women and people of color that are on the front lines of this growing threat of authoritarianism in America. And so my sister's story is just being treated like entertainment. She's being dehumanized. Like, for instance, she called me because she's watching CNN, and on CNN, she witnesses John King of CNN say that he got confirmation that Alexander Chalupa went to Ukraine to dig up dirt on Paul Manafort. What a thoughtless, stupid thing to say, because my sister has never in her life even been to Ukraine. And this is what the Manafort, Hannity, Giuliani playbook is trying to do. They're trying to get my sister into legal trouble by making her out to be a pro-Ukrainian Paul Manafort. They're trying to equate her work with Paul Manafort. They're trying to get her for FARA. They're trying to build her up as some giant beast of a political consultant who is furthering the interests of the Ukrainian government against the U.S. interests. So they're trying to make her out to be a Paul Manafort.
Right, which is insane because she's like a mom who lives in D.C. Just for those who haven't listened to our prior episodes, and by the way, we did a full-length interview with Alexander Chalupa. I think it's the only one out there where she tells her own side of the story in her own words. And, you know, Andrea's sister is a mom who has worked on and off as a political consultant. She's not a DNC operative. She did not travel to Ukraine. She was not secretly passing around documents. Like, the myth of your sister is absolutely demented. And like you said, it's coming from the Kremlin, because I think the average American, when they were hearing Nunes, you know, rattle off that name, they had no idea like what the hell he was talking about. Like, this is just a flip the script method. It's a method to try to have show trials and to try, as you just said, to create some sort of mirror image of Manafort. But my God, like, Manafort is a career dirty operative. He ran a group called the Torturers Lobby. He's like 70 years old. He's been doing this for decades. Like, to even try to put the similarity with your sister, like, would be hilarious if she weren't actually in danger and if all of these moronic journalists didn't keep botching very basic facts about her situation that put both you and her in danger.
Exactly. And so John King on CNN saying this then gets echoed by Glenn Greenwald on Twitter saying that my sister was a DNC operative that went to Ukraine to dig up dirt on Manafort. So Glenn, this again gets repeated by Glenn Greenwald. And then you have people like Seth Abramson saying, as though it's matter of fact, Seth Abramson full on says on Twitter in a single tweet as part of one of his many threads that he does, it is indeed a fact that my sister was a well-paid consultant for the DNC. Well-paid. Okay, so Seth Abramson, if you're a fan of Seth Abramson, if you love Seth Abramson, I think he can do no wrong. Well, then just understand that this is a cautionary tale of how insidious Kremlin propaganda is, that it can even infect people that we look up to or people look up to for the truth. Okay, so if you're a fan of Seth Abramson, just know that this is a cautionary tale that nobody is immune to Kremlin disinformation and how it works, because what he is repeating in a single tweet, and it doesn't matter if it's part of a larger thread where he's trying to debunk Trump's defense by going after my sister, it does not matter. A single tweet out there that is pushing Kremlin propaganda, far-right disinformation, that single tweet, the way the world works in the 21st century, that single tweet can easily be taken out of context, easily cherry-picked and put in some Breitbart piece that then goes viral and gets spread around. And that is how the cesspool works. He refused to correct this information, saying that my sister, well, she was a well-paid consultant who did work with the Ukrainian embassy to dig. And that's all bullshit. That is all bullshit. So what he's referring to is Ken Vogel's original Politico piece, which we have good reason to believe was a hit piece placed by Paul Manafort himself, because around the time Ken Vogel came around to interview my sister, she heard from a friend that the Trump transition team was asking around about her and trying to dig up dirt on her. And then Ken Vogel shows up to interview her and twists her words and launches this article, which has been the focus, obsession of Devin Nunes and Hannity and John Solomon, formerly of The Hill, and the whole cesspool of the far-right propaganda machine. And it's the only thing they have to go on. In this article, Ken Vogel took my sister's entire salary over a 12-year period working for the DNC, took her entire salary over a 12-year period and lumped it into one single sum of like $400,000 or so. And the GOP, the RNC, even took that number saying and put it into a meme that they blasted out on social media to try to make my sister look as though she got $400,000 from the DNC. She got that over a 12-year period. And if you add it all up, it's like $34,000 a year. And in fact, I can tell you, personally speaking, one of the biggest issues I've had with my sister over the years is that she was working herself to death for the DNC because she's family there. She's been there for most of her career. And she would put in all these long hours being, you know, she's that person that stays late to help out her colleagues. And I was giving her so much shit over the years that she was running herself into the ground, working too hard, getting sick, you know, and that she needed to take better care of herself. She's that kind of worker. She's that person in the office that will always be there for you. And she was getting paid shit, in my opinion. She was getting paid far less than she deserved. And now these assholes are taking her entire salary over a 12-year period and putting into one single lump sum and spreading this disinformation that she was a well-paid operative that then gets repeated by Seth Abramson. And when we ask him to correct it, he refuses. And it was just heartbreaking because here I was in Helsinki. It was like midnight, 1 a.m. I had to catch a flight in a couple hours. I was basically not going to sleep that night. I was lucky if I got 4 hours. And I'm on the phone with my sister, who's so upset because Seth Abramson is pushing disinformation about her and he refuses to correct it. And I'm up on Twitter late at night, sleep deprived, trying to ask Seth to please correct this. And he refuses to talk to her. And he has some weird defense saying that my sister even offering to speak with him, like she should speak to like the Senate committee or something, some weird thing like where he refused to talk to her and actually treated it as abnormal that she would even want to talk to him. If he is a journalist, if he claims to practice journalism, journalists issue corrections all the time. All journalists make mistakes. We're covering complex issues and mistakes happen. You address them and you correct them and it happens. You just need to fix it. It's not a big deal. There's no reason to be ashamed because it happens to everyone. The only reason to be ashamed is when you know you've made a mistake and you refuse to correct it and you refuse to talk to the source. And all he had to do was get on the phone with my sister and she would walk him through, be like, that's not correct. They took my entire salary of a 12-year period and this is just simply not correct. And she even gave him like her statement from CNN where she tried to correct these things and he just treated it for some inexplicable reason as though it confirmed what he was saying, which was simply false. I don't want to get into a debate over Seth Abramson, but I'm not interested in that. What it really hurt me is that when we try to correct this, people trashed us and kept saying stupid things like, oh, but it's part of a larger thread defending your sister. I'm like, it doesn't matter. There's a single tweet out there that where Seth Abramson treats as fact deliberate disinformation against her. That's simply false. Simply false.
Right. And it wasn't even the only error he made. He also said she was a reluctant witness, whereas she has consistently said, yes, I will testify. Yes, I want to tell my story. I mean, that's the great irony of your sister's situation is from the start, she has been trying to tell people the truth. She tried to tell people the truth about Manafort. She tried to tell them the truth about Trump and the Kremlin. She tried to tell them the truth about her own situation, her own experience, and generous reached out, you know, politely to try to get Seth to take this libelous content down, and he refused. You know, and there's another tweet he put up where he put your name instead of her name, you know, which is obviously wrong. You know, he's one of many kind of bro journalists to do this. There, you know, Matt Iglesias did the same thing. Josh Marshall did the same thing, refused to correct it as well. John Favreau did the same thing, and thankfully he did correct it.
Well, in John Favreau's credit, John Favreau apologized, which I appreciate. At this point, any acknowledgement from a white male in media, I appreciate.
So we're not mad at him because he, because as you said, everybody makes mistakes, but it is on them to correct them. And the thing that makes this so detestable is that your sister's life has been threatened for 3 years and your life by proxy, because people keep mistaking the two of you, has been threatened for 3 years. And so for him to both botch your name, say that you in fact are her, then botch her story, echoing GOP and Kremlin propaganda that has prompted death threats to her. And then she reaches out and is like, please, please, you know, change this. Like, you need to actually be accurate. And he comes up with some horse shit about, you know, oh, it's, I'm not an investigative reporter. I don't talk to actual humans. I'm a, you know, curatorial journalist, which is insane. It's an extension of this extremely creative and euphemistic way of lying and admitting saying that he was lying. You know, he did the same thing back in 2016 when he basically claimed that if he says enough times that Bernie Sanders is winning the election, then it becomes reality. You know, that there's no such thing as truth, that there's just repetition of facts to create a new reality. Well, guess who else is doing that? Trump. That is literally Trump's strategy, is getting out there and saying, what I say is true is true. It doesn't matter what the actual truth is, what you see with your eyes, what you hear with your ears, what has actually happened and has been documented. What I say is true is true. And the people who get away with shit like this, as you say, are almost always white men, because they're given this false authority. They're given this false sense that, oh, well, they must really know best, you know, versus these hysterical women or these, you know, people of color, or on and on and on. Like, we've seen this throughout American history. That's why when you read American history textbooks, they're often full of lies, because they're written by the winners, and the winners were often people who, you know, beat into submission others and then, you know, lied about the fact that was done. And so this is just an extension of that same mindset, and it's deeply troubling. Like, this is not a story where you can get things wrong, you know, where these little mistakes, they might seem little to others. They're not little to the person that they're happening to. And we've seen this with everybody implicated in this. We saw this throughout the impeachment hearings, you know, with the lies about Maria Yovanovitch, with lies and threats towards Fiona Hill, with lies towards Alexander Vindland, you know, many of which, just like the attacks on your sister, had to do with their ethnicity. Like, everyone I just listed is an American. Everyone I just listed is fighting on behalf of America, is fighting for American democracy. Yet they're called, you know, Ukrainian. And in Vindland's case, you know, anti-Semitic remarks that were questioning his loyalty were also made. And it's part of a broader narrative. And so those who deign to say that they are investigating the complexities of this story and breaking them down need to be very careful. And of course, when a person actually implicated in the story reaches out to you, yes, you should listen to them. It doesn't mean you need to like worship them or agree with them or anything like that, but you have an obligation to hear it out. And if it's something that can be objectively proven, like a salary, then yes, you need to correct it.
We will link in the show notes for this episode the tweets that we're referring to, that's between my sister and Seth Abramson, so people can follow this and see that we're not making this up. This really did happen. And also we'll link to an essay Seth Abramson wrote where he did state about truth being relative. And if you say something enough times, it becomes true. So what is Seth Abramson going to do? Keeps repeating over and over again that my sister was, well, indeed a high-paid consultant. And then that's going to make it true if he just says it enough times, when that's simply false.
It would be super nice if he could. I hope that Seth Abramson can redefine reality and just keeps tweeting that we're all millionaires.
And then suddenly money appears in our bank accounts. I would be okay with
yes,
that.
Yes, it's magic. Like a little genie. We just say the name three times and money pours from the sky.
Yeah. And I have to tell you, you know, if you're a fan of Seth Abramson's, like, because some people are attacking us and saying he's a curatorial journalist. Let me tell you something. A curatorial journalist, you know, his defenders were saying, well, he pulls information and brings it together. That is called analysis. He did not invent that. That already exists. It's called analysis. So if he's trying to invent this new phrase, curatorial journalist, which basically says that he doesn't have to talk to sources, that he doesn't have to issue corrections, that's not journalism. That's simply not journalism. That's performance art. And I can tell you, I was having brunch with a couple friends, including one who's a producer for one of the few excellent cable TV news shows that's covering all of this, you know, this whole nightmare, and doing an extraordinary job. It's a show we all know and love. And we're sitting there, and somebody asked the question, you know, what do you guys think of Seth Abramson? And the cable news TV producer and I kind of got, you know, politely quiet. And then I finally spoke up and said what we were both thinking, which was he does a good job in researching and raising questions that need to be raised, but he often crosses the line in a way that makes you uncomfortable and detracts from the good work that he does. And the cable news TV producer said, yeah, absolutely, that's it. And a very clear example of this, the Mueller report. When the Mueller report finally came out, Seth Abramson did a 400-tweet thread. I have no idea what he actually tweeted about, but I do know that he did a 400-tweet thread. Do you see what I'm saying? His antics distract from the actual work itself. And so what we're covering is very sensitive and it's difficult to believe. The facts themselves are difficult to believe. So we don't need anything that can be confused for performance art added on top of it because it distracts from the larger story. And unfortunately, Seth Abramson ventures willingly into that territory. And he really treats this not as journalism, but as some weird performance art sometimes. And it's to his own detriment. He's holding himself back by doing this. And if he can just, Sarah and I try to come to our own work with humility. We try, we make our own mistakes. We deal with that as we go along. That's how you learn and get better. And so if Seth Abramson could just sort of take that spirit and sort of approach his work with greater humility and practice actual journalism by talking to sources and issuing corrections, it would be a lot better for him. So if you support him and the work he's doing, understand that I'm bothering to even talk about this to try to help him, really, just to try to help him do better and not hold himself back.
And help any of these people, because it's not like he's unique in this respect. And I think to some degree, everybody is limited and harmed by the architecture of Twitter and by the fact that tweets can be taken out of context, even when they're in a thread. They become weaponized by outlets like Breitbart and RT. They can be faked. But what you're going to do if you're going to be a, quote, curatorial journalist, which is an analyst, which is a good thing to do. You know, it's good to analyze these works. First of all, you need to look at all of the works that are available, and then you need to analyze them in the proper context. So when you're looking at a report, for example, by Ken Vogel, who has been revealed as a propagandist, you need to keep that context of, like, why did he write this article? Is the information in this article accurate? And of course, any historian will tell you, you need to look at primary sources. You cannot ignore primary sources. And in this case, you know, the primary source was literally sitting on Twitter, like your sister was reaching out to him. But there are also interviews that she's done, you know, in her own words, like the ones she did for our show, where there's a transcript, you know, where she breaks down some of these issues. And if you're going to be comprehensive, like, you really have to be comprehensive. If your goal is just to curate, then you need to read everything and you need to be thorough. And you can't just pick weird little pieces that fit a preconceived narrative in your head. Because honestly, you know, we need more analysis. We need good, thorough analysis. And it's just a shame that so many that could be doing that, you know, to the service of the country, have just chosen a different path. Should we get into the hearings themselves?
Yeah, that sounds good.
All right. So did anything in particular stand out to you? Any particular testimony?
The end game of all of this, which was stated by the witnesses. So if you look at Alexander Vindman in his opening statement, he said, "The privilege of serving my country is not only rooted in my military service, but also my personal history. I sit here as a lieutenant colonel in the United States Army, an immigrant. My family fled the Soviet Union when I was 3.5 years old." These are immigrants that escaped. Like, look at Vindman, like, look at my sister, you know, keeps being brought up in this testimony. The Soviet Union and the trauma of that loomed large over our family. Our parents were born in refugee camps. When my mom first came to New York City by ship, the first thing she saw was a Statue of Liberty. And so I think that's so important to remember, is like why these people like Alexander Vindman are risking their lives and their careers by speaking out, is because they understand what the end game is of Donald Trump if he goes unchecked. So what we're seeing now, this authoritarian wannabe putting his laser pointer propaganda machine against private citizens and destroying their lives and like making them, like traumatizing them and their families. There's a great interview that Molly Young Fast did with Lisa Page in the Daily Beast, which goes into this in heartbreaking detail, heart-wrenching detail. And so if Donald Trump wins, if he steals another election, if he steals the 2020 presidential election, it's going to be a floodgate of horror. If you think that the idiots are in power now, wait until they steal a second term. It's going to be game over for us. I don't know how we would survive that. And the best chance we have, as we're always going on and on in the show, is the best chance you have against authoritarianism, the vaccine against it, is community. And that's why we're always going on and on and on about getting involved locally where you live on the state level. Because if we lose the federal government, the best protection you have is to make your state as blue and progressive and activated as you can as a shield, as a defense against what's happening in Washington. Because it's going to be worse than what we even have now.
Yeah, no, I agree. And on that note, you know, I wanted to read a little bit while you were gone. I wrote a few op-eds for the Globe and Mail, and one of them was on Marie Yovanovitch, you know, who, like Alexander Vindman and like your parents, is originally from Ukraine and has seen firsthand, you know, not just due to her heritage, but also because her service abroad in other former Soviet authoritarian or semi-authoritarian states, you know, places like Kyrgyzstan, you know, she's seen the brutality that these regimes can enact. She can see how long dictators can linger. I think that that's something Americans often don't quite grasp. Like, they think that because we've had a long history of changing out leaders every 4 to 8 years and not having like a complete overthrow of our constitutional principles. But once a dictator gets in, it is very hard to get them out, and life will still go on. You know, you'll still, I guess, I mean, in most cases, see your friends, raise your kids, eat your meals. You know, you'll suffer, you'll lose your freedom, you'll lose many of your resources, your material possessions. And I'm not saying that a lot of this hasn't already happened in the United States, but it's different under authoritarianism. And it's much more difficult to fight back against because you lose that basic freedom of speech. And what I wrote about her testimony, because both for her and for Vindman, it broke my heart to hear this, you know, to hear of these immigrants coming to the U.S. or their parents coming to the U.S. in search of safety, only to have that horror come home. And so I wrote, "There is nowhere for Marie Yovanovitch to go. There is no longer refuge in this world. Like many Americans, she lives in a simulation of democracy, dependent on the refusal of elites to admit the severity of the crisis. Yovanovitch swore to tell the whole truth, but to tell the whole truth is to terrify everyone. To tell the whole truth is to say what officials gloss over, but what citizens can see. This is a transnational crime syndicate masquerading as a government. There is nowhere Marie Yovanovitch can be safe because Trump is everywhere. His criminal colleagues are everywhere. And when one of them gets imprisoned, like Russian operative Paul Manafort, Trump's campaign manager who worked for Kremlin interests in Ukraine, others, like Trump's lawyer Rudy Giuliani and his indicted lackeys Lev Parnas and Igor Fruman, take their place." And then one last point. "Democratic leaders claim they want to limit the scope of impeachment proceedings to Trump's 2019 Ukraine shakedown, but that's both impossible and insulting. The 2019 Ukraine shakedown is a continuation of the 2016 election heist, which was a continuation of Trump's lifelong deference to the Kremlin and his schemes with corrupt actors from the former USSR. Limiting the impeachment scope does a grave disservice to people like Yovanovitch, whose lives are endangered by the unwillingness of officials to examine crimes in context and the refusal of institutions to hold perpetrators accountable." So again, you know, when Andrea and I are going on about the need to tell the truth, to be forthright, to be thorough, like, we're not just nitpicking. This jeopardizes people's lives. The lies and the propaganda, and yes, the sloppiness, jeopardizes people's lives. And that is one of the reasons that these testimonies are so important. And even though they're lengthy, even though they've gone, you know, for an exhausting amount of time, it is to your benefit to watch them. Like, this is one of the few venues we have left where people can tell their side of the story, you know, whether that includes the GOP rambling on, or whether it includes, you know, the Democrats trying to bring accountability in some form, or whether it includes neutral arbiters, which is really the defining characteristic of this group of witnesses, minus Gordon Sondland, who's a scumbag. But, you know, the others were career bureaucrats. And as I said in a previous episode, I think one of the reasons they were selected is because prior notable hearing subjects like James Comey or Michael Cohen come with incredible baggage. And, you know, I strongly think that these current hearings need to be linked to those prior testimonies and to the broader story of the Kremlin attacking the United States. Like, that is what this is about. I do think that the strategy, if there is one, that the Democrats are employing was to bring out people like Fiona Hill, like Marie Yovanovitch, who have just impeccable credentials, who have no history of partisanship or bias, and have them speak to the American people. And I think it's effective, but I mean, we're up against a lot. We're up against a propaganda deluge, and we're up against just incredible abuse of power and an unwillingness still among the Democrats to admit how dire things are and how high the stakes are, and that there's just not room for error.
Exactly. So we also had some breaking news out from the great Natasha Bertrand, who is a phenomenal reporter. And because she's a phenomenal reporter, she's one of the few reporters that my sister will actually get on the phone with and trust. Because that's why actually practicing journalism and adhering to the laws of journalism, where you issue corrections when needed, you talk to sources, you know, you try to always keep in mind that you're dealing with real people's lives in your reporting first and foremost. Natasha Bertrand has a very long track record of doing that. And that is why my sister will get on the phone with her and trust her. So if you have that track record as a journalist, it is to your own benefit. And anywhere Natasha Bertrand goes, we'll follow her because she's jumped around from different outlets, but she's the one that, you know, we'll invest in because she gets it. She's a true journalist. She's fantastic. And so she wrote a report for Politico, and I'll read from it now because this is really interesting that this was leaked by somebody. The Republican-controlled Senate Intelligence Committee thoroughly investigated that theory, the theory of Ken Vogel's Politico article that my sister and Ukraine colluded in the 2016 election to help Hillary and hurt Trump. And according to people with direct knowledge of the inquiry, they found no evidence that Ukraine waged a top-down interference campaign akin to the Kremlin's efforts to help Trump win in 2016. The committee's Republican chairman, Richard Burr of North Carolina, said in October 2017 that the panel would be examining, quote, collusion by either campaign during the 2016 elections. But an interview that fall with a Democratic consultant at the heart of the accusation that Kyiv meddled, Alexandra Chalupa, was fruitless, a committee source said, and Republicans didn't follow up or request any more witnesses related to the issue. The Senate interview largely focused on a political article published in January 2017 and written by Ken Vogel, according to a person with direct knowledge of the closed-door hearing, in which Chalupa was quoted as saying officials at the Ukrainian embassy were helpful to her effort to raise the alarm about Trump's campaign chairman Paul Manafort in 2016. In her Senate testimony, Chalupa denied serving as an intermediary between the Ukrainian embassy and the DNC and said she had been targeted by a Russian active measures campaign. Intelligence officials have since briefed senators on Russia's attempts to pin blame for the 2016 interference on Kyiv as part of a disinformation operation, according to a source familiar with the briefings, which were first reported by the New York Times. Chalupa confirmed to Natasha Bertrand that she was questioned by the panel. So this debunks even Seth Abramson's attempts to waddle into this. Like, this basically, look, motherfucking Seth Abramson, the Republicans themselves looked into my sister's story. The Republicans themselves looked into Ken Vogel's bullshit hit piece on my sister and found nothing there. There was nothing there because this is a disinformation campaign driven by Paul Manafort and the Kremlin, first and foremost. Again, when BuzzFeed published the Steele dossier in January 2017, Putin's Sean Hannity on Russian state media did a TV segment blaming my sister and me as her accomplice for creating this whole Russia-Trump scandal, okay? This is an entire disinformation campaign led by Manafort and the Kremlin. And you, Seth Abramson, are not immune to it. And so many others are not immune to it. And that is the problem. That is why Gaslit Nation exists and why we have to keep talking about this and confronting it, because no one is immune to it. That is the point. This gets even the people that are, you know, devoting tons of time trying to follow all this.
One more thing I want to add to this, because I think it needs to be emphasized strongly, is the GOP knows your sister didn't do anything wrong. Like, as you just said, and is now public information, she was already cleared. So when they go out there, you know, dropping this propaganda and these lies, it's not because they genuinely are wondering or are concerned about corruption or are concerned about Ukraine or even concerned about your sister. I mean, they often botch her name so badly that they're saying she's Alexander. You know, they're saying that she's a man, because these are talking points that they are handed. They're talking points that are designed by the Kremlin and their lackeys, whether Hannity or Manafort, that they are just reciting like little puppets. And I also need to emphasize here that while they are doing this, they themselves are implicated in this conspiracy. And there's no greater example of this than your sister's stalker, Devin Nunes, who midway through the impeachment hearings was revealed to have been meeting with Giuliani's partners, his indicted partners. There's an article in the Daily Beast that says, I'm going to just read a small passage, Lev Parnas, an indicted associate of Rudy Giuliani, helped arrange meetings and calls in Europe for Representative Devin Nunes in 2018. Congressional records show Nunes traveled to Europe from November 30th to December 3rd, 2018. Three of his aides, Harvey Scott Glabe and George Pappas, traveled with him per the records. U.S. government funds paid for the group's four-day trip, which cost just over $63,000. So if you're obsessing about salaries and expenditures, you might want to take a look at that. And so as this is happening, as Nunes, you know, is revealed to have been colluding with Giuliani's indicted goon squad, he is overseeing the impeachment hearings. And, you know, this is mind-blowing. This should really gravely concern Americans, not just that it's happening, not that we have so many members of the GOP who are in this crime cult surrounding Trump and whose loyalties appear to extend to the Kremlin. And, you know, I think there are various reasons for that. Some of it is threats and fear. Some is opportunism. I think a lot of it has to do with dark money being pumped into their campaigns and basically making them contaminated. But this is something where the Democrats need to fight back. And a few of them did. You know, Eric Swalwell got up and entered that article that I just read part of into the congressional record because they need to establish the extent of criminality that's happening here. Like, these are not differences of opinion being expressed at these hearings. These are political maneuvers being part of the hearings. They turn the impeachment hearings into show trials. That is the goal of Nunes. It's certainly the goal of people like Bill Barr, who, as I talk, you know, is out there putting out legal propaganda, which is more dangerous than media propaganda because he actually can have the power to rewrite the law, to preemptively exonerate the guilty and to persecute the innocent. That is the goal. And that is what they're going to try to use these hearings for. And, you know, we did a little mini episode after the first set of hearings just to get our initial thoughts out, where you pointed out that the House needs to keep these hearings going for as long as possible for numerous reasons. You know, first, because this Ukraine crisis is obviously tied in to the broader 2016 crisis and the decades of Trump and Manafort and other people's links to Kremlin-linked organized crime. You know, that is what is at the heart of the story. That needs to be brought out into the open. Mueller failed, Comey failed, the FBI failed. It needs to be revealed in full to the public on the congressional record. He also needs to be impeached for other crimes like abuse of migrants at the border, abuse of the pardon power. These are very serious offenses and they need to be stopped now. You know, the abuse of migrants at the border, the separation of families needs to be stopped now. But we also need to set a precedent because if we're ever going to get out of this, if there's going to be another president, they need to not have this ability to look back at this time and shrug and be like, well, you know, Congress said it was okay, or this is an acceptable pattern of behavior. Because what people are going to remember in decades from now is not going to be like the minutiae of the Ukraine transcript of Trump's little conversation with Zelensky. What they're going to remember is that children died in cages on the border of Texas and Mexico. They're going to remember that breastfeeding infants were wrenched out of their mother's arms and taken away, and then that parent was deported, and that people just sat back and they did nothing, and they let it happen, and they said, oh, you know, we don't want to get into a partisan dispute, or, oh, we need to just focus on one issue for impeachment. Like, the depravity, the heartlessness on display here is so vile. And so, yes, we need to keep these impeachment hearings going for that reason. But you also pointed out, Andrea, that when we get to the Senate, we're going to have a new series of problems due to Mitch McConnell. Do you want to expand on that point? Because I thought that was an interesting observation.
Right. I mean, the reason why the House wants to keep impeachment for as long as possible, because when it goes to the Senate, it's going to be full-blown banana republic, because Mitch McConnell, who has no morals, he's as corrupt as he's part of this coalition of corruption, him and his wife. So as soon as this goes to the Senate, what's going to happen is they're going to basically bring in people like my sister and just try to terrorize her. And you're not going to have an Adam Schiff following procedure and the rule of law and, you know, refusing to allow witnesses to be intimidated in the halls of Congress and so forth. And it's just going to be a bloodbath on our democracy under Mitch McConnell's watch. And because that's how they are. The Republicans are aligned with Putin because they behave like Putin. There's no middle ground with them. They push for everything. They want everything. As you said earlier, you mentioned Zelensky. It is so deeply unfair for anybody to ask Zelensky to clear the record on what really happened between him and Trump. He simply cannot do that. Ukraine is dependent on the U.S. as one of its largest donors. And for him to say anything that might anger a mob boss, Russian mafia mobbed up president, Donald Trump, who is beyond vindictive, who's had an enemies list that he acts on for years, that's into intimidation and blackmail and all of it. Zelensky is a hostage in this situation. He has the lives of his citizens literally on the line. And what Russia has been doing is continuing its invasion. You have these so-called humanitarian trucks that are just massive convoys of big trucks filled with supplies that have been crossing the border from Russia into Russian-occupied Ukraine. And we've just in the last month alone had swarms of these trucks entering the Donbas area. I'm reading now from one information agency out of Ukraine. The 93rd humanitarian convoy, quote unquote, consisted of 42 trucks. The press service of the Ukrainian Border Guard service said Russia sends 92nd. Wow, dear God. So this is very dangerous for Ukraine. So what Putin can do and what Putin has done is openly attacked Ukraine, as we saw in the Kerch Strait. And he can push deeper and grab more territory, kill more Ukrainians and so forth. So again, like Donald Trump's presidency comes with a massive body count from the Kurds in Syria to the children on the border to Ukrainian soldiers that were desperately needed that U.S. aid that was held up. So Donald Trump and his goon squad could extort the president of Ukraine. So this is unbelievably dire, the situation that we're in.
That's one of these things, like lost in all of this kind of partisan maneuvering and this horse race coverage of both, you know, the 2020 election, but also impeachment. You know, we get these kind of ridiculous articles like, how is it affecting the views of the Democrats? And, you know, how is it affecting like whether people will turn out to vote? Like the fate of the free world is at stake. Like, I don't know how to overstate this, you know, and I don't want to state this in a way that plays down atrocities that have been committed, you know, by the American government, whether in other countries or on our own country. But we are heading as a world in a new direction, a direction guided by, but not limited to, the machinations of the Kremlin. We're guided by a transnational crime syndicate that has infiltrated multiple governments. You know, you're seeing it in the UK. You're seeing it now in France, where you see Macron basically capitulating to Putin over NATO. We saw it in Poland, in Hungary. We see it in Turkey. You know, we see it in longstanding authoritarian states like Saudi Arabia. We see it in states like Israel, where Netanyahu will simply not leave despite his indictments. It's this consolidation of corruption, and it has very real human consequences. As people go on about, ooh, will Ukraine catch on with Americans? Ukrainians are dying and have been for half a decade, you know, since Russia invaded in Crimea and then began to escalate its war because of the failure of the West to step in. You know, that failure of the West, it's the same in Syria, it's the same in Ukraine, and eventually it will be the same in the West as we get devoured from within by complicit actors. And, you know, that is one of the reasons it is so important for the propaganda and the narratives that are allowing these atrocities to take place to kind of go under the radar, even though that seems almost impossible because they're so horrific. You would think everyone would be watching them. They get glossed over. They become, you know, political talking points instead of crises that humanity should be addressing. And, you know, one thing to just briefly comment again on the hearings, where we saw the immediate value of it is after the hearings, a lot of GOP representatives went on to reiterate this talking point, you know, that it was Ukraine who interfered in the 2016 election, that Ukraine was to blame for everything. And finally, journalists understood that this was propaganda because Fiona Hill had gotten up at the hearing and laid out the propaganda narrative in a very clear, very simple way, simple enough that even Chuck Todd could understand it. And because of that, there was actual pushback against the GOP by people like, you know, miracle of all miracles, Chuck Todd. I also love how they get like accolades for doing like the, you know, baseline minimum of efforts here, but nonetheless,
for doing their jobs.
For fun. finally doing their job. But nonetheless, it's good. They understand this is a preconceived narrative that has been pushed by Fox News, pushed by The Hill, pushed by The New York Times, pushed by Politico, both of which by Ken Vogel. And they recognize it and therefore are much more effective in fighting against it. And, you know, that is also why we have this show. But, you know, our show is not going to compare to the neutral ground of congressional hearings. And so, yes, these need to go on for as long as humanly possible.
And I want to point out that Google Maps and Apple Maps both showed on their maps Crimea as being part of Russia. Crimea that is still suffering under human rights abuses under Russian occupation. And that is what happens when you have a Russian mob boss in the most powerful position in the world as president of the United States. And he was brought to that position with the help of the Kremlin. And he's now in the UK for a NATO summit. And Europe is in crisis because for years, Russia has been funding far-right parties across Europe. And Russia has been driving disinformation campaigns across Europe, including sending something like 150,000 Twitter accounts to drive disinformation to help create confusion in the Brexit vote, which has been a big destabilization force against British citizens and also is pulling the UK out of the EU. So here NATO is meeting, as Macron called it, like a brain-dead NATO, because you have the president of the United States being an asset of Russia, and NATO was founded to counter Kremlin aggression. You had states like the Baltic states on the border of Russia that couldn't wait to get in. NATO expansion happened because you had so many states that lived under Kremlin occupation during the Iron Curtain period that they couldn't wait to sign up for NATO membership, because these were traumatized populations that know what Kremlin occupation and aggression is like firsthand. And so now you have NATO in crisis because the big funder of NATO, right? That is an issue. Everybody has to pay their fair share without question. But Trump isn't demanding that NATO pays its fair share out of any sort of strategic understanding of NATO's purpose. He's doing that because that's Trump. And so I just want to say it's a dangerous time. Even Macron, who wants to emerge as the leader of Europe, he's even trying to welcome Russia back into the club and saying a lot of things that are alarming Ukraine watchers, which basically just signals that Ukraine has never been more vulnerable. And without a strong, united EU, without the United States, Ukraine is on its own. And Putin is going to take advantage of that because Putin was the architect of this and has been for years. And I want to close by really bringing it home by talking again about the incredible interview with Lisa Page in The Daily Beast by Molly Young Fast, where she describes a lot of the experiences, a lot of the trauma that my sister has gone through being a target of the far-right propaganda campaign. Lisa Page, of course, was a lawyer for many years at the DOJ. She was an expert on, and the FBI, she was an expert on the Russian mafia. And she understood the enemy very well. And she talks about how she's even afraid to go in physical spaces because the president has turned her into such a target. And just like my sister, she cannot opt out of this. She lives with this. It can flare up at any time, and it does. And so Donald Trump has his rotating targets that he lashes out on, and Lisa Page is one. My sister and Ukraine are another, of course. And you could wake up one morning and your day is shot because he's gone after you again, and all of his MAGA monkeys are going after you, and you're the whole cesspool is fired up and targeted at you that day, that week, and it disturbs you. You live with it. It disturbs your family, the people that care about you. It is trauma. It is trauma, and it is ongoing, and it may never end. It may never end. I saw Liz Wall, who quit her job as an RT broadcaster. She was an anchor for RT, and she quit on air because of the Soviet history that was in her own family, and she couldn't stand seeing what the Kremlin was doing to Ukraine. So she quit on air in a major protest against Kremlin aggression. And I saw her, I think, a year or two after that, and she was showing me that all these Kremlin bots were relentlessly harassing her, because if you do anything to stand up against the Kremlin, they will hound you. All these patriots like Vindman and others that are taking this stand, they're doing it at great risk and threat to not only themselves, but their families. And so that carries so much more weight and power in the decisions of them to come forward. And I just hope people keep that in mind. And just to really sort of hit this home even further, with this report that my sister gave testimony to the Senate Intelligence Committee in the fall of 2017, I just so happened to learn around that same time that the great Pulitzer Prize winning historian Anne Applebaum, in her book, Red Famine, Stalin's War in Ukraine, I learned from that book, because Anne Applebaum and I shared a historical advisor, and that historical advisor for my film and Anne Applebaum's book, Red Famine, that historical advisor in her research uncovered hours of testimony that my grandfather gave the U.S. Congress about surviving Stalin's genocide famine in Ukraine. So I got to hear my grandfather's voice many years after he'd passed away. And I was so excited about this discovery and the fact that my grandfather was cited in Anne Applebaum's book, Red Famine, that I sent it to my sister. I was so thrilled. And later she told me that she received this news right before her Senate testimony. Because that's what this is about. That is what all of this is about, is preventing the end game. And so let's not forget that. Our discussion continues, and you can get access to that by signing up on our Patreon at the Truth Teller level or higher.
We want to encourage our listeners to donate to Raises, a Texas-based nonprofit agency that provides free and low-cost legal services to underserved immigrant children, families, and refugees. They're helping with the crisis facing migrant families